the first session, I expected that we have four speakers in the opening session, so I estimated about an hour, but they finished earlier. So even though we had a 10-minute break, we have to start 15 minutes earlier. But there are so many important issues, so I'm glad to start the first session earlier. We have very distinguished presenters and discussants. And let me introduce presenters and discussants. You can see at the program page 8. Victor Cha, I don't think he needs an introduction from me because he is very well known to Korean audience. He served as a director of Asian Affairs in White House during the Bush administration, and Victor went back to his school and teaching at Georgetown University. And also he had a second hand recently, so leading the Korean Center at the CSIS, the important Washington-based think tank. And next presenter, Choi Kang, is a very well-known expert in Korean security affairs, and he worked for Qaeda and now researching at the IFANS. And third presenter is Evans Ribier. Evans has many good Korean friends here, and Evans, as all of us know, was a DCM at the U.S. Embassy in Seoul, and after back to Washington, D.C., he is now the senior director of the Albright Stonebridge. But I heard Evans is enjoying teaching at Princeton University, at the university he graduated from. And we also have six excellent discussants. And I will just call their name and their official title only because you can see their bios in the program. And Woo-suk Choi, journalist of Joseon Ilbo, and Patrick Cronin, the CNS senior advisor, and Abraham Denmark, fellow of the CNS, and Han Seok-hee, professor of Yonsei University, and Hyung-jin Kim, director general of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Trade, and lastly, and Sang-yeon Lee, senior research fellow at Sejong Institute. Because I'd like to open some the questions from the floor, I would like to ask about 15 minutes to three presenters, and later I'll invite about 7 to 8 minutes of comments from discussions. So without further ado, let me introduce Victor as a first presenter of the first session. Victor.
Thank you very much, Chairman Lee, and thank you to EAI and to CNS for hosting this very important conference. Mayor Kim of Pyeongtaek, it's a pleasure to be here with you today. Chairman Lee, who is Yeonggu, who is not only a colleague I respect dearly, but also a good family friend, it's a pleasure to see you here too. Chairman Yu, as well of the National Assembly. And I want to say also I'm particularly happy here to be here in Seoul with Admiral Weisskopf, who has as you saw from his bio, a very distinguished career in the United States Navy. But what many people don't know is that he was also director of the White House Situation Room, which is one of, maybe next to the president, probably the most important job at the White House, because when things are going well or in a crisis, he has to make sure everything runs as it should. And most importantly, for the rest of us staff, White House staff, he had to make sure that the president was happy. And he did make sure the president was happy, because if the president wasn't happy, he would take it out on the staff. So we're really grateful to Admiral Weisskopf for all he did there as well. My topic today is on the rise of China, which is something I'm happy to talk about because I'm kind of tired of talking about North Korea. And I thought the way I'd approach this, I think I was asked to do this as the first speaker to sort of paint a wider picture or scene of how we think about the rise of China. And I will try to do that in the short time that I have been given. When I teach international relations at Georgetown, in the first class, the very first question I ask the students is, I ask them, what is the single most important unanswered question in international relations today? And students raise their hand and they say the war on terrorism, finding Osama bin Laden, the Middle East peace process. And I tell them that I think, at least, the most important unanswered question in international relations today is how the international system is going to deal with the rise of China. Because the answer to that question will affect the way we study international relations from now on. And in thinking about this, how the international system deals with the rise of China, I think there's sort of three ways or three schools of thought in terms of how one can think about this. The first is what, from an international relations perspective, one might call from an offensive realist perspective, right? And essentially the idea here is that in an offensive realist world, states, as they seek more power, as they seek more capabilities, they don't only seek these capabilities to survive, they also see a desire to change the external environment in which they live. Right? So all nation states are security-seeking states. All of them are concerned about taking care of themselves. But if from an offensive realist perspective, as states grow in power, they not only seek their own security, but they also seek to try to affect or change the international system in which they live, to try to change it to suit their needs, because this is the most effective way of trying to influence or trying to maintain one's security. So if you take this offensive realist view of China's rise, what you see is a more muscular China in terms of its foreign policy. You see a China that, as it rises, wants to redefine the rules of the international system, wants to create its own new rules and its own new institutions by which to govern the international system. And this perspective naturally means that there will probably be some sort of clash of interests, at least, at the minimum, between the rising power and the lead power in the system, right? Between China and the United States. For offensive realists, this is almost a law-like attribute of international relations, that as countries grow in power, they seek to control their environment. And particularly as countries grow in power, as they grow in economic capabilities, they will eventually seek to dominate the system. Right? Offensive realists would point to countries throughout history that have done this: Britain, France, the Soviet Union, Nazi Germany, Imperial Japan, the United States. All of these countries, as they grew in their capabilities, sought to change the external environment in ways that suited their interests. A second way of looking at the rise of China is what you might call, or what we call in international relations, from a defensive realist perspective. Right? And defensive realism essentially says that states all seek power to survive, but overall, a rising power's intentions may not necessarily be revisionist. In other words, they may not seek to completely overturn the system, but they may seek to grow in power, but largely remain pretty much status quo. That their ambitions overall are limited. Their ambitions are not to overtake or undercut the existing system, but to change it in ways that are limited in scope, enough to be secure, but not in a way that overextends. Right? That would be from a defensive realist perspective. And so I think from this view, the rise of China would be something that would be somewhat limited in scope, that China would largely be confined to securing its interests within its immediate geographical area, the things that it cares most about, Taiwan, Tibet, and you know, to a degree, out to the South China Sea. And that essentially what the rise of China will mean will be some sort of accommodation where you have what Robert Ross at Boston College calls a maritime accommodation on the one hand involving the United States, Japan, Australia, and a continental accommodation on the other, largely centered around China. And that this does not necessarily mean that there will be conflict between the lead power in the system and the rising power. And then the third view in terms of thinking about how China's rise affects international relations is, and I apologize for the jargon, is from a neoliberal institutionalist perspective. Right? And then the basic idea here is that changes in the distribution of power in the international system that are created by rising states, they can create conflict and instability, but the potential for conflict and instability can be muted by, right, can be sort of lowered by embedding the rising power in the current norms and rules of the international system, right? You know, such that the rising power feels it wants to be a part of the current system rather than seeking to overturn that system. Right? From this view, the rise of China is not necessarily a zero-sum game. Right? As China grows in power, it will try to play by, contribute to the international system. It will become a part of all of the international institutions that govern the globe, and that it will become a contributing member, one that becomes a rule abider and sees abiding by these rules as being in its interests. Right? And in international relations, this particular view is associated with scholars like John Eikenberry at Princeton and some others. So the first, at least conceptual point I want to make here is that, I mean, how the rise of China turns out will greatly determine how we study international relations from this day forward. If China ends up rising and becoming a part of the international system, playing by its rules, becoming a contributing member, then the way we study and teach international relations, whether it's at Georgetown or the Naval War College or at Weiyambu Yongguan, wherever it is, we will be talking about how liberal institutionalism really is sort of our framework for understanding international relations. On the other hand, if the rise of China leads to conflict, where China seeks to overturn the system and seeks to undercut the system that has been created since World War II, then offensive realism will be the way we understand and teach international relations. So I think there's a tremendous amount riding on the question of China's rise and how it affects the way we study and think about international relations. So that's the first conceptual point. Second point is on policy. I think that the clearest statement from a policy perspective from the United States about how to think about the rise of China is essentially an idea that has been associated with the former Deputy Secretary of State and now President of the World Bank, Robert Zoellick, when he talked about this concept of China becoming a responsible stakeholder. And the idea was essentially, although I don't know if Bob would put himself in this category, was essentially this a liberal sort of institutionalist argument that as China rises in power, it needs to contribute more to the public goods of the international system. What do we mean by public goods? Things like counterproliferation, climate change, freedom of navigation, a host of things that are all seen to be important in the international system. This to me was the clearest statement of a U.S. grand strategy with regard to China for quite some time. And at certain points, I think, during the Bush administration, the previous administration, it did lead to some good cooperation between the United States and China on a number of issues. I think the Obama administration, who came in and really tried to push this concept of strategic stakeholder to the next level. I think the Zelic view of this was that China needs to become a responsible stakeholder, with the emphasis on the verb needs. And I think for the Obama administration, the change was that they really pushed China. They didn't say that China needs to become a responsible stakeholder. They said that China was now a responsible stakeholder, and that it has to play a role, whether it's Copenhagen, Iran, North Korea, these sorts of things. This led many media to talk about the so-called G2, the group of two of the United States and China, basically deciding a lot of the global agenda. I think what we have found thus far is that China is not ready to play that role. I mean, China may need to, or as a future aspirational point, may want to become a responsible stakeholder, but it is not ready to play that role now. That its behavior recently has largely been quite parochial, that it has not been public goods oriented, public goods provision oriented, and that any contributions that China has made to public goods, whether this is signing on to counterproliferation sanctions against Iran, or making small appreciation in their currency, these have largely been tactical moves. They haven't represented a genuine understanding of China's desire to be a responsible stakeholder. So the result is that there is currently a great deal of disillusionment with China in the international system. And unlike many other administrations, the Obama administration has already in 2.5 years or 2 years come a long way in its views on China. Arguably, almost every other past U.S. administration has followed a certain pattern in terms of China relations, which is they start out very tough on China, and then over the course of 4 years, they end up with a much more pragmatically oriented policy of cooperation with China. You could certainly say that about the George Bush administration, the George H.W. Bush administration, and the Clinton administration. But the Obama administration started out in almost the complete mirror image. They started out very willing to engage with China, to see it in a G2 context. And after their first year, were quite disappointed in the results, and now have moved much more to a policy that really is actually, I think, in my mind, more normal with China, that it is not an effusive engagement, that it is a relationship in which there is competition, there are complaints, there are things that we want them to do, that they want us to do. And people now say the relationship is bad. I don't think it's bad. It's normal. This is sort of what we normally expect in U.S.-China relations. The one other point I wanted to make on U.S. views is, as all of you know, here in the United States, we just had midterm elections. And what was very interesting to observe in these elections was that for the first time in quite some time, first time that I can remember, China was actually an issue in the elections. It became an issue in the campaign. And what is interesting here is that the public views, the American public views on China, are very different from the sort of elite policymaking views. As I just described to you, the elite policymaking views now tends to be a good bit of disappointment with China, that they haven't played the role that people had hoped that they would play, that in fact they may not be ready to play that role. But the public view of China is completely different. I mean, the American public view of China, especially as it was during the campaign, was a China that is rich, which is completely wrong, and a China that owns the United States because it owns so much of our debt. So there's a big gap in the way the American public and the elite policymakers view China these days. Third point is that this evolution of views on China is not just specific to the United States, it's also the case here in Korea. I'm condensing a lot of history, but I think it's safe to say that from the mid-1980s up until 1992, there was a real euphoria here in this country about improving ties with China, right? For historical reasons, for a variety of other reasons, such that when normalization happened in 1992, it was genuinely welcomed in this country. I mean, people really saw it as something that was quite important. Then from about 1992 till February 2010, there was still a great deal of interest in improving relations with China, but there was also a creeping realization that the more you interacted with China, the more the difference in values became apparent. South Korea being an open liberal democracy, China being the country that it was, that the interaction was just not as fluid as everybody presumed that it might be. And we particularly saw this in the business sector, among small and medium-sized businesses that rushed to China after normalization, then found a lot of difficulties in terms of doing business there, and then came back to Korea after a bit of disillusionment. Now, of course, from March 2010 till today, there's been a fundamental shift in the way Koreans view China, largely as a result of the Chun'an and the Yongpyeon artillery shelling, but I think for the first time, and I would say across the spectrum in Korea, not just conservatives, but progressives as well, views of China have changed, and that there are concerns that there may be a fundamental conflict of interest between the between South Korea and China when it comes to North Korea. This leads to my final point, which is, you know, why is China not being more helpful on North Korea? Why is China supporting the North rather than working with the other parties to reduce the potential for escalation or for provocation? And here I think there are essentially four hypotheses that are out there, right? And I'll go through them very quickly, and they will be my last points. One hypothesis is essentially that China is not working with us on North Korea because they don't want to. Right. This would be sort of the offensive realist view would be that China doesn't want to work with us on North Korea. They want to support the transition, the leadership transition in North Korea. They want to maintain close ties with whatever emerges in North Korea after Kim Jong-il because they want to maintain the buffer state. They want to maintain sort of this buffer in North Korea. Second hypothesis is that China doesn't want to help us on North Korea because it sees the North Korea problem as a good way to distract and preoccupy the United States. It saps our attention, it forces us to focus on this rather than to focus on the rise of China, and therefore it intentionally does not want this problem to be solved. A third view for why China does not support us on North Korea is that it's not so much that it doesn't want to, but that China's basically incapable of persuading or changing North Korean behavior. That Chinese diplomacy is overrated, that they actually do not have a good record of persuading countries to do things that they want them to do, and therefore the problem is not that China intentionally doesn't help South Korea and the United States on North Korea. It's just incapable. It can't do it. Right? And then the fourth view, and it's the one that I'm increasingly becoming more aligned with, is that China does not support or help on North Korea. It is capable of doing this, but it is just afraid of doing this. That essentially China knows it has all the leverage, all the tools in terms of putting pressure on the North to denuclearize or to stop conventional provocations, but it is also afraid that if it uses that leverage, it could lead to some sort of collapse or unraveling of the system. And that China, this has become even more of a dilemma for China as it becomes the sole patron to North Korea. Because as the sole patron to North Korea, anything that it does could potentially lead to a collapse of the regime. And the Chinese have no reliable metric for determining how much pressure is enough or how much pressure could lead to denuclearization versus how much pressure could lead to collapse. So I'm sure in the discussion there'll be other explanations, but those were the ones I wanted to put on the table. I think I've gone over my time limit, Chairman, so thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to be here today.
Thank you, Dr. Lee Suk-jung, and I'd like to thank you, EAI and CNS, for giving me this wonderful opportunity to share my view on North Korea. If you allow me, let me speak in Korean, because the majority of the audience is Korean. I 회의가 아주 중요한 시점에 개최되었다고 생각을 합니다. 그리고 우리의 반성이 먼저 있어야 될 것으로 생각합니다. 과거 우리가 북한의 위협을 얼마나 제대로 인식하고 평가해 왔는지에 대한 반성이 먼저 있어야 될 것으로 봅니다. 북한의 위협을 제대로 평가하기보다는 객관적이고 과학적으로 평가하기보다는 이념적 성향에 의해서 그 평가가 좌지우지되어 왔던 것으로 생각됩니다. 따라서 천안함 사건과 연평도 포격 사건 이후 그리고 우라늄 농축시설 공개 이후 우리는 보다 객관적인 북한의 도전과 위협에 대한 평가를 전제로 해서 우리의 대책을 강구해 나가야 될 것으로 생각됩니다. 그리고 또한 우리의 그 wishful thinking을 좀 배제한 상태에서 비교적 컨서버티브하게 북한 위협을 평가해야 될 것을 봅니다. 대개의 경우 북한 위협을 평가하는 데 있어서 그냥 단순한 능력에 대한 평가, 뭐 소위 말해서 빈 카운팅이죠. 무슨 무기를 몇 개나 갖고 있다라는 이러한 것을 벗어나서 북한이 과연 자신들이 가지고 있는 군사력을 어떻게 어떠한 정치적 군사적 목적을 가지고 사용할 것인가에 대한 좀 상상력을 발휘해 가면서 우리가 북한 위협을 평가해야 될 것으로 생각됩니다. 불행히도 지금 현재의 안보 상황은 과거에 비해서 그렇게 좋아졌다고 평가할 수 없을 것으로 봅니다. 간단히 말하자면 북한의 위협은 굉장히 다변화했다. 그리고 복잡하게 변화해 왔다. 뭐 과거 우리는 주로 북한의 전면전 위협에 대해서 얘기를 많이 해왔습니다. 그러나 한 과거 또 한 10년간은 또 북한의 그 WMD 핵 문제에 대해서만 관심을 가져왔습니다. 재래식 위협에 대해서는 그렇게 큰 높은 평가를 하지 않았습니다. 재래식 위협 평가에 대해서 가장 많이 인용되고 있고 할 수 있는 것은 페리 보고서에 나와 있는 부분일 것으로 생각됩니다. 북한은 전면전을 도발할 능력이 없고 도발할 가능성도 상당히 낮다. 물론 이제 자체 능력도 있지만 한미연합방위체제의 능력이 충분하기 때문에 그렇다라는 전제로부터 시작됐습니다. 그러나 천안함 사건이라든가 연평도 사건은 북한이 자신들이 가지고 있는 군사력을 매우 다양하게 사용할 수 있고 우리는 그러한 군사적 도전과 위협에 매우 취약하다는 점을 여실히 보여준 사건들이었다고 생각됩니다. 북한은 과거 한두 개의 군사적 수단을 가지고 있었지만 지금은 다양한 수단을 보다 다양한 수단을 가지고 있습니다. 북한의 경제력이 감소되었다 할지라도 그리고 앞으로 계속 지속적으로 감소되어 나간다 할지라도 북한은 현재 수준에서의 군사력을 유지할 수는 있을 것 같다는 것이 제 개인적인 평가입니다. 따라서 어떠한 경우에 있어서도 북한의 군사력을 과소평가해서는 안 될 것이고 가능성 하나하나에 대해서도 매우 심각하고 신중한 평가와 분석 그리고 대책을 강구해 나가야 될 것을 봅니다. 제가 사용하고 있는 것은 Complexity of North Korea Threat or Multiplying North Korean Threat이라고 저는 생각합니다. 즉 현재 우리가 직면하고 있는 것은 네 가지 위협이라고 생각하고 있습니다. 첫 번째는 북한의 재래식 군사력으로부터 오는 위협. 물론 이것은 재래식 군사력의 재래식 사용 가능성도 있지만 재래식 군사력의 비재래식적 사용, 비정규적 사용 매우 심각한 상황이라고 생각할 수 있습니다. 두 번째는 대량 살상 무기 능력의 지속적 증강입니다. 지난 11월 12일 북한은 해커 박사를 불러서 우라늄 농축시설을 공개했습니다. 과연 이 농축시설이 북한이 가지고 있는 단 하나의 우라늄 농축시설인가 라는 것에는 의문을 가질 수밖에 없습니다. 아마 추가적으로 두 개 나아가 세 개 이상의 비밀스러운 장소에 이미 보관되어 있고 가동 중인 농축시설의 존재 가능성을 배제할 수 없을 것입니다. 제가 북한이라면 미국에게 나의 그 귀중하고 소중한 시설을 공개함으로써 무엇을 얻으려고 할 것인가. 이미 벌써 북한 스스로 생각할 것입니다. 아, 이건 앞으로 군사 상황 시 타겟이 될 것이다. 그렇다면 그 타겟을 하나만 가지고 있을 것인가? 저라면 반드시 두 서너 곳에 분산시켜서 우라늄 시설을 보관할 것입니다. 북한이 가지고 있는 플루토늄은 아마 거의 끝나가는 단계 아닌가 생각됩니다. 이미 8,000개의 폐연료병은 재처리를 했을 가능성이 높고 그리고 약 우리가 추정하고 있는 14,000개의 새로운 연료병 뭐 다시 리프로세싱을 한다 할지라도 그것으로 끝날 가능성이 높다. 그럼 앞으로 북한은 우라늄 농축 프로그램을 지속적으로 가동해서 핵 능력을 증강시켜 나갈 것으로 봅니다. 북한으로서는 이러한 핵 능력의 지속이야말로 체제 안전을 유지하는 데 가장 핵심적인 수단으로 생각할 것입니다. 세 번째 우리가 직면하고 있는 문제는 2008년 후반부 이후 불거져 나오기 시작한 김정일 위원장의 건강 이상과 권력 승계 그리고 그것으로부터 발생할 수 있는 체제 불안정성의 문제가 되겠습니다. 물론 과연 북한 체제가 이 권력 승계 과정이 안정적으로 유지되어 갈 것인가라는 것은 여러 가지 이론이 있을 수 있습니다. 그러나 이 문제 자체는 우리에게 새로운 도전을 안겨준다라고 봅니다. 자세한 부분은 나중에 말씀드리도록 하겠습니다. 그리고 네 번째 도전은 우리가 좀 간과하기 쉬운 문제인데요. 소위 말해서 그 휴먼 시큐리티, 인간 안보의 도전이라고 생각합니다. 아마 얼마 전 조선일보에 그런 그 기사가 하나 났습니다. 한 세대가 거의 그 영양 실조로 인해서 발육이 완전히 정지된 상태로 나타나 있고 30, 40대가 특히 그것에 큰 충격을 받고 있다. 즉 기아, 건강의 문제, 환경의 문제가 모두 복합적으로 북한 내에 존재하고 있다는 것이고 이것은 우리가 새로운 공동체 건설에 나가면서 굉장히 중대한 도전으로 우리에게 다가올 것으로 보여집니다. 이런 네 가지 도전이 앞으로 있다라는 것을 전제하면서 우리의 대응도 단순 대응, 즉 대중적 1대1 대응이 아니라 좀 더 복합적인 대응을 구상해 나가야 될 것으로 봅니다. 다시 좀 강론적인 부분에 대해서 말씀드리도록 하겠습니다. 먼저 재래식 위협 부분에 대해서 말씀드리자면은 아마 잘 아실 겁니다. 이미 연평도 사건을 통해서 나타났지만 재래식 전력의 비재래식적 운영 방법을 앞으로도 북한은 지속적으로 발전시켜 나갈 것으로 봅니다. 뭐 야포를 이용한다든가 아니면은 특전 부대를 이용한다든가 기타 등등 테러와 유사한 형태의 위협을 충분히 줄 수 있을 것이고 가능성도 배제할 수 없을 것으로 생각됩니다. 이런 재래식 도전을 어떻게 예방하고 대처해 나갈 것인가에 대해서 매우 심각하게 고민하고 우리가 노력을 경주해야 될 시기로 봅니다. 현재로서 단기간 내 이것을 극복하기는 상당히 어렵습니다. 우리 사회가 정보화되고 발전됨에 따라서 우리의 취약성은 상대적으로 더 증가했다고 볼 수 있습니다. 따라서 우리가 취할 수 있는 방법은 공세적인 방어를 취할 것인가 방어적인 방어를 취할 것인가 라는 선택이 있을 수 있겠습니다. 저 개인적으로는 복합적, 즉 공세적인 방법과 방어적인 방법 두 가지를 다 동시에 추구해 나가야 될 것으로 보여집니다. 지금 상황에서 볼 적에는 대개 우리가 그 군사적인 부분에 대해서만 굉장히 너무 많이 강조를 하고 있는데 이 억지라는 방법을 좀 비군사적인 수단과 혼합해서 효용성을 높일 수 있는 방향적으로 추진해 나가야 될 것입니다. 그것이 예를 들어서 한중 간의 어떤 북한 문제에 대한 공감대를 확장시켜 나간다든가 중국과의 협력 강화 등등을 우리가 고려해 볼 수 있겠습니다. 두 번째, 북한의 대량살상 무기 위협과 관련해서 두 가지 종류의 위협이 있다고 봅니다. 사용의 문제와 하나는 확산의 문제가 될 것입니다. 우라늄 농축 프로그램 두 가지 문제를 다 복합적으로 제기하고 있다고 볼 수 있겠습니다. 북한이 지속적으로 우라늄 농축 프로그램을 추진할 경우 상당량의 그 무기급 우라늄을 획득할 수 있을 것이며 이것은 단순한 사용이 넘어서 사용의 수준을 넘어서 확산의 가능성과 위협을 더 증폭시켜 나갈 것으로 봅니다. 이러한 문제에 대해서 우리가 어떻게 공동으로 대처할 것인가에 대해서 협의를 해야 될 것이고 또한 한미 간의 협의를 통해서 현재 논의되고 있는 확장 억지의 문제를 좀 더 심각하게 고민해 봐야 될 것입니다. 북한의 핵 프로그램은 기존에 우리가 가지고 있던 대응 계획이라든가 한반도 상황에서의 군사적 현실을 근본적으로 변화시켰다는 것에 대해서 우리가 심각한 고민을 해야 될 것이고 그러한 변화 사항을 충분히 고려해서 우리의 대응 태세도 발전시켜 나가야 될 것으로 봅니다. 따라서 앞으로 우리가 생각해야 될 것은 북한이 어떠한 형태로 자신들이 갖고 있는 비대칭 전력을 사용하려 할 것인가에 대해서 좀 더 많은 관심을 갖고 분석해 나가면서 그것을 기준으로 해서 차근차근 대응 체계를 구축해 나가야 될 것으로 봅니다. 아마 내년 3월부터 개최하기로 했던 확장 억제 정책위원회를 통해서 그러한 내용이 좀 더 발전시켜 나갈 것으로 봅니다. 이것과 관련해서 물론 자해력 위협과 관련해서 마찬가지입니다. 가장 중요한 것은 첩보와 정보 확보 능력이자 또한 그것을 분석하는 능력이 되겠습니다. 즉 휴먼웨어, 소프트웨어, 하드웨어 3박자가 잘 맞아 떨어져 나가면서 우리가 균형된 그런 대응 태세를 갖추어 나가야 될 것으로 봅니다. 세 번째, 그 권력 승계와 체제 불안정성 문제. 저 개인적으로는 지금 현재 상태로서는 그렇게 체제 불안정성이 증가하고 있지 않다라고 생각이 됩니다만 장기적으로 볼 땐 가능성이 높아진다라고 생각됩니다. 정치적으로는 안정돼 있으나 경제적, 사회적으로는 잠재적 불안정 요소가 증가하고 있는 것은 사실입니다. 그러나 현재 왜 정치적인 안정이 유지되고 있는가 하는 것은 그 미래에 대한 불확실성이 너무 크기 때문에 현 체제에 만족해하고 현 체제를 유지하려고 하는 그룹이 형성되어 있지 않나라는 그런 추정을 해볼 수 있겠습니다. 따라서 우리가 북한에 대해 그 대안적 미래, alternative future를 제공을 하고 또한 보다 정보의 유입을 증강시켜 나간다면 북한 체제의 변화의 가능성은 더 증가할 것으로 봅니다. 문제는 이런 변화의 과정을 우리가 과연 안정적으로 관리하고 발전시켜 나갈 수 있을 것인가 하는 것입니다. 따라서 이러한 과정 속에서 발생할 수 있을지도 모른 여러 가지 컨틴전스에 대해서 우리가 대비를 해나가는 것도 너무나 당연한 일이라고 생각이 됩니다. 컨틴전스를 준비한다고 하는 것은 컨틴전스를 바래서 하는 것이 아니라 혹시도 있을 수 있는 그런 상황에서 우리가 그 악영향, 피해를 최소화하고 보다 발전적인 방향으로 발전시켜 나가기 위해서 그러한 것이 필요하다고 생각이 됩니다. 만약에 체제 불안정이 발생했을 경우에는 다양한 도전이 발생할 수 있습니다. 전쟁보다도 더 복잡하고 아주 델리케이트한 문제가 발생할 수가 있습니다. 뭐 구체적인 이해를 들기는 좀 시간이 많이 소요되기 때문에 생략을 하기로 하고요. 이것이 한국 단독으로 해결하기에는 굉장히 어려운 도전이 될 것으로 봅니다. 따라서 관련국들과 많은 협의가 있어야 될 것이고요. 그래서 공동의 그 목표가 무엇인지를 좀 더 명확히 해야 될 것입니다. 가장 중요한 것은 우리가 가지고 있는 한반도에서의 최종 상황에 대한 바람직한 비전을 제시함으로써 관련국들의 협조와 지지를 받아나가는 것이 좋을 것으로 생각되고요. 그러한 차원에서 통일에 대한 우리의 바램, 그러한 통일을 추진해가는 과정을 다시 한번 짚어볼 필요가 있다고 생각이 됩니다. 마지막으로 인간 안보의 문제, 우리가 북한 문제를 생각하면서 인간 안보를 생각하지 않을 수 없습니다. 현재 인간 안보의 상황이 어떤지 우리가 자세히 파악을 할 수가 없습니다. 그러나 식량이 절대적으로 부족하고 의료체계가 이미 망가져 있는 상태이고 그리고 환경오염도 심각한 상태이고 토양의 손실도 역시 심각한 상태입니다. 그리고 뭐 잘 아시다시피 매년 홍수와 가뭄이 반복적으로 발생하고 있다라는 것은 앞으로 우리가 통합 북한과의 통합을 추진해 나가는 과정에서 우리가 해결해야 될 중대한 도전이라고 생각됩니다. 또 따라서 우리의 차원에서 볼 적에는 이 인간 안보에 대한 관심을 앞으로 좀 더 높여 나가야겠다라는 생각이 듭니다. 단순한 군사 안보뿐만 아니라 인간 안보, 즉 동포적 차원에서 인간 안보의 문제를 우리가 어떻게 해결해 나갈 것인가에 대해서 고민해 봐야 될 것으로 봅니다. 앞으로의 정책 대안에 대해서 말씀드리자면은 비교적 북한 정권이 오래 갈 것이다. 그리고 기존의 정책 라인에서 큰 변화가 없을 것이다. 라는 차원에서 우리가 앞으로의 상황을 점진적으로 개선해 나가는 방향을 취해야 될 것으로 보며 그것의 가장 근간이 되어야 할 것은 역시 신뢰할 수 있는 연합방위체제와 주변국의 협조라고 생각이 됩니다. 즉 당분간 앞으로도 상당 기간 동안 안보 위주의 접근이 필요하다라고 보고 그것이야말로 북한이 정책 선택의 폭을 제한하면서 나아가 정책의 변화를 초래할 수 있는 그러한 방안으로 생각이 듭니다. 특히 북한이 최근에 와서 사용하고 있는 즉 부정적 힘, 네거티브 파워를 제한하고 감소시켜 나가는 국제적 협력과 협조가 필요합니다. 이러한 차원에서 볼 때 한국, 중국, 미국 간의 협력이라든가 한미일 간의 협력도 필요할 것이고요. 북한 문제에 대한 좀 더 큰 틀에서의 공감대 형성을 위해서는 5자 협의도 필요하다고 생각됩니다. 군사적인 차원에서는 군사력 현대화라든가 이런 첨단화에만 신경을 쓸 것이 아니라 국방의 기본이 무엇인가에 대해서 우리가 다시 한번 검토하고 기본을 확실히 해 나가는 접근이 필요하다고 생각됩니다. 결론적으로 말씀드리자면은 북한을 뒤쫓아가면서 대응하기보다는 북한으로 하여금 우리를 따라오도록 하기 위한 전략을 취해 나갈 것을 봅니다. 이상으로 발표를 마치겠습니다.
This forum at such a critical juncture in the history of Korea. And of course, let me also thank Mayor Kim and the good people of Pyeongtaek for their support for this forum. It is an honor for me to participate in these discussions today, and it's a real delight for me to be back in Seoul. I have many pleasant memories of my service here over the last 41 years on and off. It just occurred to me as I was coming into the room that this is the 41st year that I've been working on in or around Korea. Most of my fondest memories of that period are the time that I spent working on Korean affairs. And I do indeed have many good friends and colleagues in the room, and it would take me the rest of the hour to recognize all of them, so I won't. But I would be remiss in my duties if I did not acknowledge the tremendous service of one good friend and eminent statesman, Prime Minister Lee Jong-gu, who spoke earlier this morning, who has probably done more for his country and more for this alliance than any other single person that I know. The backdrop to today's discussions, as has already been made clear, are a series of very disturbing events that have created an almost unprecedented sense of concern in Korea today. And of course, those are the March 26th sinking of the Cheonan and the tragic and shocking loss of lives in that attack, and of course, more recently, the attack on Yeonpyeongdo also resulted in a loss of lives, and also, not that anybody needs to be reminded of this, the first time that artillery shells have fallen on Korean soil since the Korean War. And then, of course, as has already been mentioned, the recent worrisome revelations about North Korea's uranium enrichment facility at Yongbyon, the revelations of which confirmed many of the long-standing suspicions that we have had about the fact that North Korea was indeed developing an alternative path to nuclear weapons development. All of these things represent, in my view, a very stark and sobering reminder of the tremendous challenges facing this bilateral alliance today, and of the critical importance and continuing importance of that alliance in dealing with the very real threats that we face today. And so as we talk about new developments and new initiatives in this alliance partnership that we have here, I think it's important to keep one very simple but important thing clearly in mind, and that is that the core threat that formed the foundation of this alliance relationship in the middle of the previous century is very much with us today. And as a result, there is considerable work to be done in the here and now to deal with a volatile, provocative, and dangerous North Korea. And there is also much work that needs to be done to provide for the continuing defense of the Republic of Korea. And in light of all that, it seems to me that skeptics in the audience might question my purpose here for this segment. I'm supposed to talk about planning for the future. And a skeptic might say, well, shouldn't you really be paying a lot of attention to what's going on right now and not what's going to happen 5, 10, or 15, or 20 years from now, because the enemy is literally at the gates? I acknowledge that point, but let me deal with this possible skepticism by just recalling a recent experience I had here in Seoul at another conference, where just after the attack on Yeongpyeongdo, I was asked to talk about South Korea's soft power. It seemed more than a bit ironic at the time that I was being asked to talk about South Korea's soft power so soon after the demonstration by North Korea of some of their hard power. But I made the point at this conference just a couple of weeks ago that the Republic of Korea's soft power, the widespread admiration and respect that South Korea has in the eyes of the international community, the attractiveness of its economic success, the fact of its amazingly successful democratic transition, and the appeal of its culture, all of those things had played an extremely important role in gaining Korea international support and sympathy after the Chun'an and Yongpyeong attacks. And accordingly, I also made the point that efforts by the Republic of Korea to continue to amass and store up this soft power made eminently good sense, even during these troubled times. But at the same time, I offered some additional words of advice, and that is that the Republic of Korea should keep its powder dry as it deals with the current challenge posed by the North. And just as the Republic of Korea is capable of walking on two legs, soft power and hard power, I think all of us today don't need to be reminded of the fact that this alliance is also capable of dealing both with the proximate threat that it faces today and at the same time marshaling the energy and the vision needed to strengthen and deepen cooperation as we try to take this bilateral partnership up to the next level. That kind of forward-looking thinking was at the core of the communique issued at the end of the June 2009 summit between President Obama and President Lee when they agreed on a joint vision statement for the future of the US-ROK alliance. That statement declared that our two countries, and here I'm quoting, are, quote, building an alliance to ensure a peaceful, secure, and prosperous future for the Korean Peninsula, the Asia-Pacific region, and the world, unquote. And that ambitious vision was built on a foundation that was laid by President Lee and President Bush in their summit at Camp David in April of 2008. And both of these initiatives were extremely important steps forward in a bilateral relationship that has seen some difficult times over the years. And I don't have to remind anybody in this audience that these steps forward in the relationship actually had their origins in some real concerns that existed not too long ago, in the not too distant past, that there was some serious potential for drift in the US-ROK alliance partnership. There was a feeling as you will recall, that the United States and the ROK were not necessarily on the same page on some core issues in the relationship, and that the disappearance of North Korea, the hoped-for disappearance of North Korea as a threat in the future, could also remove the glue that had held the alliance together for so long. And so an interest on the part of both countries in reshaping the alliance was driven by a concern that the alliance's justification needed to be broadened, and that this justification needed to go beyond just the North Korean threat if this important partnership was to survive into the future. Obviously, that North Korean threat has not disappeared. In fact, as has already been pointed out by the previous speakers, it's grown. And there is a little concern now that this important justification for the alliance is going to disappear anytime soon. In fact, as others in this conference have already discussed, and as we'll be talking about some more in the next sessions, building a game plan and a strategy for dealing with the eventual demise of North Korea has become an important new task in bilateral alliance coordination, adding an important new dimension to alliance planning for the future. And thanks to a lot of hard work on both sides, and also thanks to political changes in both of our countries, our two governments are again on the same page on core alliance issues, including North Korea. And this has enabled leaders in both of our countries now to turn their attention to the positive alliance agenda of adding further depth and further breadth and substance to this important partnership. And this important development has been driven in large part by the fact that Korea, and many Koreans do believe, that they have more to contribute to the alliance as an equal partner, not only in dealing with peninsular matters or regional security matters, but also globally. And this laudable ambition is a reflection of the Republic of Korea's growing self-confidence. And that self-confidence has grown in direct proportion to Korea's economic success, the higher international profile Korea enjoys thanks to its world-class industries and products, and its growing soft power. And today, Korea has a very strong and respected voice in the international community. And as we all know, a Korean is Secretary General of the United Nations. And that fact has helped Koreans raise their heads even higher in the international community today, and to seek even other opportunities to demonstrate Korea's leadership in world affairs. And there's perhaps no better example of that than the superb stewardship shown by President Lee in the Republic of Korea as Korea hosted and chaired the recent G20 meeting here in Seoul, where some of the most urgent economic challenges facing the international community today were on the agenda. And Korea is also very confidently pursuing new economic and trade partnerships with key economies around the world, including the EU, and I'm delighted to say with the United States, and I'm very encouraged that the recent U.S. ROK negotiations on the FTA have come to a conclusion, and that we will see a whole new dimension added to this important bilateral relationship. Korea's leadership, this kind of Korean leadership, is also going to be in evidence in 2 years' time as Korea hosts the next nuclear security summit in 2012. And reflecting on all of this, all of these examples of South Korean leadership and energy and contribution, one of the points that I want to leave you with here today is that the Republic of Korea's significant soft power and its determination to play a leadership role in international affairs and the wide respect and admiration that it enjoys can and should serve as the basis for playing an even greater international role in the future, and that should include, in my view, a greater role in cooperation with the United States in the global arena. We've seen in the past Korea contribute to efforts in Iraq and in Afghanistan, and these are examples of how Korea's determination to contribute to resolving conflicts in distant regions can add an important dimension to US-ROK bilateral cooperation. And we've seen Korea's contributions to relief operations in Haiti, to anti-piracy efforts in the Gulf of Aden, and to the UN mission in Lebanon. All of these things reflect an enhanced interest on the part of Korea in making a real contribution to peace and stability in other parts of the globe. And these sorts of contributions, if coordinated with US efforts in the months and years to come, could serve as a valuable force multiplier as we go forward in tackling these and other challenges. There are other areas that Korea can and should contribute to, in my view. For well-known reasons, Korea has a particular interest in efforts to control the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction and related technology, material, and know-how. And this, of course, has been a major reason for Korea's active participation in the Proliferation Security Initiative. And here, too, Korea's efforts could be married with those of the United States in other key regions to deal with the ongoing threat that we see and the ongoing threat to the global nonproliferation regime that we see from the spread of WMD and related technology and systems. And in addition to nonproliferation, as you look down the areas of possible cooperation, it's easy to envision other areas where Korea and the United States could work together and marry our efforts and our energies and our skills together in ways that are very beneficial to the globe. And here I would include such things as the search for energy security and dealing with climate change. Another potentially fruitful area of cooperation would be to establish a bilateral coordination mechanism for our respective official development assistance efforts in other parts of the world. In all of these areas, and in more that I don't have time to mention, greater bilateral cooperation would ease strain on our respected limited government resources and allow for a rational division of labor between us, and enable each side to bring its unique strengths to bear on many of these and other issues. And I have no doubt that American leaders would welcome efforts to create a broader and deeper alliance relationship with a more global scope. But from my perspective, as I draw my remarks to a conclusion here, a key question that remains in this regard is whether the Republic of Korea is ready to press ahead in this regard. Despite the evident enthusiasm of President Lee and his administration for a more globalized alliance, it indeed remains to be seen if the Korean people will share this aspiration of a broader and deeper and more globalized alliance relationship. Politics in Korea are very complicated, and clear divisions remain on many issues today, including the nature and scope and the future of the US-ROK alliance, despite the progress that we've seen. In some quarters, there are remaining suspicions about US intentions and US policies, particularly those that might bind the Republic of Korea to political or diplomatic courses that some here might feel a bit uncomfortable with. But I'm nevertheless hopeful that the strong, unstinting support shown by the United States for the Republic of Korea in these difficult times has eased and maybe even has removed some of these lingering suspicions about US motivations. And perhaps the clear support shown by the United States for our Korean allies has served as a powerful reminder to our Korean friends that in your hour of difficulty, Korea can always count on the United States for support. And so looking to the future, political developments in Korea will ultimately determine whether and to what extent Korea wants a more globalized partnership with the United States. And if they do, Koreans and their government are going to have to define those areas where they see themselves as particularly able to contribute. And Korea will, of course, need to ensure that it develops the infrastructure, the software, the assets, and the capabilities necessary to support its engagement in a broader and deeper and more globalized partnership. And if Korea does so, I am certain it's going to find a United States ally that is fully prepared to work even more closely with it in building the more global partnership that our leaders have held out as the next logical and important step forward in this evolving and successful partnership. Let me end there.